now let's go ahead and think about how many workers a profit-maximizing firm would hire. And that's going to depend on how much the firm is going to pay those workers. And let's go ahead and say that the firm can hire workers for a wage of $100, $100 a day. So how much money does the firm make by hiring the first worker? Well, the first worker adds $190 to revenue, and if they hired them for $100, they increase their profits by $90 by hiring that worker. The second worker produces $170 worth of output, and if you can hire them for $100, you make yourself $70 better off by hiring them. And so on and so forth down the line. Any worker that produces more than $100 worth of output is profitable to hire. So this firm wants to hire 5 workers if the price of output is $10 and the workers each are paid a wage of $100. This 6th worker here is not profitable to hire. Notice, if we had looked at the average revenue product, we would want to hire all 7 workers, which would actually be a mistake. The 6th worker only adds $90 to revenue, but we paid him $100, so we'd lose $10 by hiring them. And the 7th worker produces $70 worth of output, and we paid them $100, so we would decrease our profits by $30 by hiring that worker. Okay, so there's one example. Let me go ahead and say, let's see what happens if the price of the output changes. So let's suppose the price of our output drops from $10 to $5. Actually, that's going to be too far. Let me go ahead and use a different number there, because that's going to make none of the workers profitable to hire if the wage stays the same. So let's suppose instead, and I'm going to make life hard for myself here, that the price of the output drops to something like $8. So in that case, we're going to go ahead and have total revenue be 8 times 19, which is maybe 152, something like that. And over here, 8 times 17 is going to be 80 plus 7 times 8. So 80 plus 56, maybe 136. And 8 times 15 is 120. And 8 times 13 is 80 plus 24, 104, 88. Excuse me here. I mistakenly computed the, put these in the wrong column. And 72 and 56. There we go. So I was computing the marginal revenue product rather than the total revenue. Okay, because essentially we don't need to know total revenue. If we have marginal physical product and we know the price of our output, we can just multiply marginal physical product times the price of our output and get marginal revenue product. Okay, so if wages are $100, how many workers do we want to hire now? Well, in that case, the first worker is still profitable, not as profitable as before, but we make ourselves $52 better off if we can hire them for $100. Second worker is still profitable. Third worker is still profitable. Fourth worker is still profitable, but the 5th worker is no longer profitable. Because now that the price of the output has declined, this person's economic productivity has fallen, even though their physical productivity is unchanged. So we cut back on how many workers we want to hire. Notice we would also get a change in the number of workers we want to hire if the level of wages changes. If the level of wages rises, say for instance, to $115, then worker number 4 is no longer profitable and we only want to hire 3. So, let me go ahead and review some of the formulas that I've stated in words, but haven't yet written out in algebra yet. So, marginal physical product of labor is the change in total product over the change in the amount of labor we use. Average physical product is just total product over the amount of labor we use. Marginal revenue product of labor equals total revenue, the change in total revenue, over the change in the amount of labor we use. And then finally, average revenue product equals total revenue over the amount of labor we use. Okay, so those are the equations. There are going to be some sort of typical shapes to these things if we were to draw them as graphs. First, let's talk about the production function. A typical production function would have a shape that looks something like this, where we have total product on this axis and the quantity of labor on this axis. And what we have here is that it's steeper at first and flatter later. And if we were to graph, the marginal physical product, it would look something like that. So the marginal physical product measures the slope of the total product curve. And so what we have here is a case of what we call diminishing returns, or more technically, decreasing marginal productivity of labor. Because each incremental unit of labor, this first unit of labor had a high marginal productivity, this second unit had a lower marginal productivity, this third unit a still lower marginal productivity, and so on. How are those curves affected by different changes out there? We generally think that if this is our total product curve and this is our quantity of labor curve, if we have a more plentiful supply of the other inputs, so we have more land if we're talking about a farm, if we have more capital if we're talking about a factory, a more plentiful supply of the input means that at any given level of labor, we can have a higher level of production, because our workers have more and better equipment or more and better land to work with. So we get a shift upward in the production function. An increase in technology would do the same thing. An increase in technology would mean that for any given level of labor, we can produce more output. So more of the other inputs or a higher level of production causes a shift upward in the total product curve. And if we were to look at the marginal product curve, you can maybe see here that this second total product curve up here is steeper at every point. So the marginal physical product curve would shift right also. Would shift up also. Here we had an upward shift, which was left. Here we had an upward shift, which was right. How does this all translate in terms of the marginal revenue product? The marginal revenue product graph, we have something in dollars over here, because revenue is measured in dollars, and we have labor on this axis. And the first worker produces a lot of output, and so the first worker has a high marginal revenue product. The second worker a somewhat lower marginal revenue product, and so on and so forth. Because essentially, at any given point, if we have a nice, perfectly competitive firm, the marginal revenue product equals the price of the output times the marginal physical product, as we saw in our previous examples. So what's going to cause this marginal revenue product curve to shift? Well, if the output price rises, then this curve is going to shift up and out. Or if our workers become more productive because they have more of those other inputs to work with, more land, more capital, or if they have better technology, any of those things are going to cause this marginal revenue product curve to shift out. So we have higher output prices, or better tech, or more of the other inputs. If, on the other hand, we had a fall in output prices, as we saw in the previous numerical example, or if we somehow had a technological retrogression that we fell back into the dark ages and forgot how to use email or something, or if we lost some of our inputs, then we would have a leftward shift of this marginal revenue product curve. And we sort of saw in the last numerical example that the marginal revenue product is what determines how many workers a firm wants to hire. In particular, if the wage is here, the firm wants to hire all these workers right here, because all those workers produce more than they cost us. So all of these workers are profitable to hire. These workers over here, they have a marginal revenue product that is below their wage, so they are not profitable to hire. So the marginal revenue product curve is, in fact, the labor demand curve. And that's where we'll go ahead and end this.